This video examines the major features of Earth's surface relative to the distribution of important Earth processes. Any conceptual model of how Earth works, like plate tectonics, must be able to explain these patterns. When we refer to features, we're mostly focusing on the physical characteristics of the ocean floor and mountain ranges on the continents. Processes in this case involve earthquakes and volcanic eruption. We'll start with this figure. It's a global relief model of Earth's surface that illustrates the topography of the land and the bathymetry of the ocean basins, and it lets us see the contrasting elevations of features on the continents and on the ocean floor. The darker brown colors indicate higher elevations on land. Darker shades of blue signify the deepest parts of the ocean. Lighter blue colors indicate shallow conditions. The first feature we'll highlight is a relatively wide oceanic ridge system that can be traced through all the ocean basins. While higher than the surrounding ocean floor, the crest of the ridge system is still about 2.5 kilometers, or about 8,000 feet, below sea level. As you learn more about plate tectonics, you'll discover how such a large feature could form on the ocean floor. Elsewhere, in the interiors of the ocean basins, we can sometimes find narrow, linear chains of islands. These represent submarine volcanoes that have grown tall enough to rise above the sea surface. The most famous of these are the Hawaiian Islands. When we look more closely, we can recognize that this island chain has relatively few islands and is mainly composed of seamounts or submarine volcanoes. Here are a couple of other island chains in the Pacific Ocean. As we'll discover, these island chains form very differently from the oceanic ridges. The very deepest parts of the ocean are found in narrow trenches, typically along the margins of some ocean basins. For example, we can identify a trench along the western edge of the South American continent. Trenches are also associated with another feature we want to introduce, island arcs. These are also chains of islands, but they have a crescent shape rather than a linear shape, so they form a curved line on the Earth's surface. These are common in the western Pacific Ocean, and one of these trenches, the Mariana Trench, represents the deepest part of the world's oceans at 11 kilometers depth, or around 36,000 feet. This oblique view of the Mariana Trench makes it clear that the island arc is set a couple of hundred kilometers west of the trench, and is actually made up of both islands, here in green, and seamounts, in brown colors. Plate tectonics needs to explain the gap between the trench and the location of the arc, as well as the different processes that give us both curved chains of islands and linear island chains. In contrast to the examples we just described, there are many oceanic margins that do not have trenches. Instead, these locations feature shallow continental shelves that step down into the ocean basin. This is what that looks like along the east coast of the North American continent. The continental shelf is actually the true edge of the continent. This gives us something else to explain. Why are some continents and oceans separate by trenches, while others are not? Talking about continents, let's take a closer look at where some of the tallest mountains are located. There are only three places on Earth where we find mountains over 6 kilometers in height, or around 20,000 feet or more. There are hundreds of them in the Himalayas. There are dozens in the Andes Mountains of South America. And there's one in North America, Denali in Alaska. What set of geological conditions created this apparently unusual setting? If we take a closer look at North America, we find that the elevation of the mountain ranges increased to the west. The 10 tallest peaks on the continent are all in Alaska. How will plate tectonics help us explain this pattern? Shifting gears from features to processes, let's look at where we find earthquakes. This map shows the distribution of moderate to large earthquakes over a recent 30-day period. You may notice that it isn't a random pattern, and that the earthquakes seem to be concentrated near some of the features we discussed earlier. Let's do the same thing for recent volcanic eruptions. And by recent, I'm talking in geological terms. We're thinking about volcanoes that erupted in the last 10,000 years. Again, how do these patterns compare to what we've seen earlier? Let's put the earthquakes and the volcanoes side by side. Which of the features listed toward the bottom of the slide best match up with the distribution of earthquakes and volcanoes? You can pause the video here to think about it if you'd like for a few moments. Both earthquakes and volcanoes are adjacent to trenches found near continental margins and island arcs, and they appear to be common in association with mountain ranges. In contrast, oceanic ridges are outlined by a modest number of earthquakes, especially in the Atlantic Ocean, but not too many volcanoes. If we look at the wider continental shelves, these locations are much quieter. Hence, they're often referred to as passive margins. Geologists collectively label processes such as earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, and mountain building as examples of tectonic activity, and divide the outer layers of Earth into tectonic plates based on these patterns. As you'll soon learn, the relative motions of these plates cause the processes, cause the earthquakes and volcanoes, and create the features we described earlier. The largest plates are typically named after an associated continent or ocean. This lesson sets the scene for a more in-depth discussion of plate tectonics. By the time you've finished, you should be able to explain how features such as oceanic ridges and island arcs form, and how the distribution of these features is likely to change in Earth's future. Now, how confident are you that you could successfully address the learning objective for this video?